Hello, lovelies. You're listening to episode 77 of the Broken Enchantments podcast, written and read by Elizabeth Wheatley. That's me. I hope you enjoy this week's episode. Be sure to check out my Patreon for next week's episode, now available. You can check out the links below. Happy listening. The sensation of falling awoke Janir as she tumbled to the floor, tangled in the blankets and the bed's netting as she did. Her hands were knotted around the constancy star in a death grip. An imprint of the wires encircling the stone marked her fingers in bright red slashes. Janir sat up, half expecting to see Malkalar swoop from the shadows, but she was alone. Clambering to her feet, Janir paused. Outside, there was shouting, thudding, and the rattle of steel. The door to her chambers burst open. Even in the meager light, Janir recognized Kanakade's silhouette. She couldn't make out his expression, but one hand gripped the hilt of a sheathed carcotton.
"Get dressed," Kanakade ordered. "We're under attack."
Under attack? Who would be attacking Tarkoth? Or had the monks turned against the Argotolems?
"Morsains," Kanakade tersely announced. "They found a breach in the temple's lower defenses. Get dressed," he repeated, slamming the door shut.
Janir shimmied out of her nightgown and into a sturdy tunic and trousers she hunted out of the wardrobe. Janir found a pair of sandals that pinched her toes, but it was better than walking barefoot. Janir instinctively searched for her carcotton, then remembered they were still in the possession of her father. She would have to do without. With perfect timing, Kanakade burst back into the room. Not saying a word, he marched straight to Janir and seized her arm. As he dragged her out, Cerulius met them in the hall.
"She ready?"
"Yes,"
Kanakade shortly replied.
"Good."
Kanakade released her arm, and they herded her between them down the hall. Everything was dark, shadowed. The candles had been snuffed out. What of Saoven, Carisle, and the others? They would be trapped if the Morsains reached the prisons. Before she could speak, she was ushered into a bright room, teeming with people. Argotolems and enchanters scurried to and fro like rats. There was not yet a feeling of panic, but the tension only danger could bring hung like an axe about to fall. In the center, the Lord Argotolem stood over a table with a map of the temple spread before him. Jorman Nufar, Drusilla, and an enchanter Janir assumed must be one of Jorman's underlings, leaned over the map, pointing to various sections.
"They breached us here."
Jorman's underling, a woman with a golden nose ring, pointed a calloused finger to the catacombs.
"It's normally under warding enchantments. That's why we didn't have guards posted. But the wards seem to have vanished."
"What do you mean, vanished?"
Jorman repeated.
"Wards do not simply vanish."
The underling shook her head.
"But they can be destroyed,"
the Lord Argotolem calmly stated.
"You think we're being attacked with that kind of magic?"
Drusilla asked.
"Someone destroyed the wards,"
the Lord Argotolem simply answered. Janir gulped as her father looked up from the map and found her between Cerulius and Kanakade. She froze. She wanted to scream that she had no idea what had happened, that she was not so foolish as to unleash a horde of murderous fiends in hopes of escaping. She and Lucan had passed through enchantments, yes, but they had been intact. Would her father punish her for it? How many times could she help his enemies? How many times could she disappoint him and keep her friends alive?
"Don't give him any trouble,"
Cerulius growled, indicating Kanakade. With that,
He marched off to speak with another Mortan. They spoke in quick, terse phrases, inaudible in the clamor. Kanikade slipped one hand around her arm.
"Where is Saoven?"
Janir demanded.
"Not now,"
Kanikade shortly replied.
"Please."
Janir tugged against him.
"I need to know. I..."
"The prisons are on the opposite side of the breach. They're fine."
The Mortan looked past her dismissively.
"Don't worry about it."
Janir's mind whirred. Could she believe him? Even if they were safe, what guarantee did she have that they would stay that way? Armor clanked and voices clamored louder. Janir managed to piece together that the Morsains had managed to control two hallways below. Through shouted words and hastily relayed commands, Janir gathered that the temple's guard were holding them off. The enchanters should have been able to repel the attack, but the Morsains seemed infinite. However many there were, they were clearly strong enough to hold their ground against Tathanzian magic wielders. The Lord Argatalam began instructing a number of his warriors. The Mortana who had escorted Janir and Lucan up from the catacombs marched away with a dozen warriors in her wake. Malkalar's promise of death rang in Janir's memory, like execution drums. It had to have been him. Jorman Nufar braced his weathered hands over the table.
"I told you that thing would bring death to us all. It is the curse of the chalice."
"You will do as I say if you want your people to keep their powers,"
the Lord Argatalam boomed in response. It was not so much wrathfully as loudly spoken. Janir was sure everyone in the room heard.
"You force us to carry on with this thing. You sentence both my people and yours to death. If you..."
"Still your prattling tongue."
The Lord Argatalam then dropped his voice and said something else to the enchanter, never once blinking. The other enchanters in the room stared with fear. They were as much prisoners as Janir, and they must know it. Jorman recoiled. He was unaccustomed to being silenced like a child, but what could he do? The Lord Argatalam was the real one in control here. Frantic shouts came from nearby. The doors across the room burst open and Morsains, dozens of them, flooded into the council chamber. Karkatan shrieked. Morsains howled in pain. The Lord Argatalam took command, ordering an offensive formation to push the animals back. A keening wail shattered the glass windows overhead and the Morsains shrieked in pain. Janir didn't have time to see who had ground their Karkatan together. She covered her head and ducked to avoid the rain of glass shards. Kanikade shoved her behind him and had his Karkatan out in an instant. The keening stopped abruptly and the Lord Argatalam's voice rang over the noise. Janir couldn't make out the words, but just hearing his voice made something inside her harden and take root. Something about hearing his voice made her want to stand and fight and... what was happening? This wasn't natural. Despite her father taking control, the room exploded into chaos. Morsains were everywhere. Scuttling up the walls across the floor over the remnants of the ceiling, they came like an army of giant cockroaches. Kanikade pushed Janir backwards.
"Watch her," he ordered.
It wasn't until her brother caught her that she realized who she'd been handed to. Kanikade whirled around to join the other Argatalams in the fight. The Morsains were stalled. It took the merest touch to send one of them careening to the ground as a corpse, but the things seemed to have no self-preservation. They threw themselves over the dead bodies of their comrades to attack, even as they were mowed down. Where had all these creatures come from? Surely they couldn't all have been hiding in the temple's necropolis. Lucan spun her around to face him and grabbed her hand. He pressed something tangled and metal into her palm. Closing her fingers over it, he covertly glanced around the room. Stealing a look downwards, Janir found a ring of keys clasped in her hand. She looked back to her brother. Lucan shouted,
"Get them out!"
With that, he disappeared into the fray of their father's warriors, distancing himself from her as fast as possible.
Was he trying to get her killed? Even if she was playing into a trap, she had to try. She would never, ever forgive herself if something happened to any of them, especially Saoven and Kariel. Janir ran out the door and headed back down the hallway. Out of the council room, she could still hear the sounds of conflict echoing through the temple. A group of temple maidens, scantily clad in their nighttime apparel, scurried past her, whimpering like frightened animals. Janir continued on, heart thrumming a staccato. She kept on expecting Cerulius or Canicade to come after her, but the battle must have distracted them. Things never went this simply. Janir broke into a brisk run as the sounds of battle grew louder. It was difficult to choose her path in the darkness, but she did her best to remember the route to the dungeons. At least now she had some familiarity with the temple layout. As she sought the dungeons, the keys jangling in her fist, she tried to think this through. Once she freed her companions, they would need to get out of the temple. So long as the drawbridge was still down, they could sneak into the stables, find their horses, and ride out. Hopefully. Janir gulped. She could only pray the morsains wouldn't follow them. What of her father? There was still a deal to be honored with him. The thought of what he would do should she back out was terrifying. Was there any way she could get Armandius and Saoven to leave without her? Not in 1,000 years. It wasn't a pleasant thought, but she might have to trick them. If she had to, she would see the others to the outskirts of Tithansia, then ride back with Colbo. Janir's heart wrenched anew at the thought of leaving Saoven. She would probably never see him again. She wanted to cry, but there wasn't any time. Once she got close, it wasn't too difficult to locate the jail by the smell. Rotting, moldy stench tainted the air. Janir gripped the keys tightly. She tried not to think about what would happen if the morsains broke through to this portion of the temple. Right now, she just needed to focus on the task at hand. She was slightly surprised to find the upper door to the prison unguarded. Where had the jailer gone? Cautiously, she pushed open the door. It creaked on rusty hinges so loudly Janir thought it could have just as easily been a frightened rabbit. Swallowing, she jogged down the steps, keys jangling in her hands, heart racing faster by the moment. Almost the moment she began descending the steps, faces rushed to peer out the cell doors.
Janir!
Janir! Kariel and Saoven exclaimed in unison. Their joyful cries were closely followed by a chorus of her name from the others.
Shh!
She exclaimed, pressing a finger to her lips.
Janir, what's going on?
Armandius demanded. There's a horde of morsains attacking, Janir explained, stepping to the closest cell, which happened to be that of Kariel and Saoven. She experimented with the different keys, praying that Lucan hadn't given her a false set. They found a breach in the temple's defenses and are trying to kill us all from the look of it.
Morsains?
Velasquez incredulously echoed.
Yes, just trust me, please. You need to get out of here.
Janir shoved the third key into the lock and it finally sprang open. Saoven and Kariel barreled out at the same time.
Are you all right?
The enchanter demanded. Saoven would probably have swept her into his arms if Armandius hadn't been watching, but the look on his face spoke volumes.
What's going on?
He whispered. Keeping his voice down, he glanced to her clean clothes and tended appearance. It made her feel guilty all over again.
Later, Janir whispered back. We need to get out of here. Now.
Saoven took the keys. Kariel, see if our weapons are anywhere nearby. The elf whirled around and strode to unlock the rest of the cells, leaving the enchanter and Argatolum to their task. Janir and Kariel scurried up the stairs to the jailer's compartment. Once they reached the top, Janir took stock of the guardroom. It was shabby and ramshackle, with everything from fresh quills to petrified bread crusts. Down in the dungeon, Janir could hear Saoven had all but freed the others and would be with them in a moment. They needed to hurry. The pair tore through the heaps of flotsam, but found nothing more dangerous than an old apple core. The weapons weren't here. Kariel sighed.
Well, It was a long shot, anyway. He shoved a stubby candle aside and watched it roll across the uneven floor. Are you still planning on...
Yes.
Janir pretended to look through a stack of moth-eaten blankets, though she knew full well there was nothing to find. But now that we're all together, don't, Kyle. Janir snapped. She looked back to the darkness of the cells.
They're not here,
she called, trying not to raise her voice too much.
That's fine, Saoven shouted back. I wasn't expecting them to be.
Janir. Kyle dropped his voice to just above a whisper. He tugged on the sleeve of her tunic. Janir?
Don't.
She repeated. She refused to look at him. They didn't have time, and she didn't have the willpower for this argument. Kyle was quiet for a moment.
Just don't let them take your soul, he whispered.
Kyle wrapped his arms around her waist. Janir hugged him back, certain that his absence would leave a gaping hole. He barely rose to her neck, and she stooped to press her face against his shoulder.
It'll be all right. I promise, he said.
Their moment ended when the others emerged from the dungeons. Janir felt even more guilt, realizing she was the cleanest and best-tended one of them all. Gwenna was startlingly lean. She took Armandius's hand to help her ascend the stairs. Janir tried to keep from staring at the familiar way they interacted. Come to think of it, Armandius had never expressly denied that he and Gwenna had. Velasquez and Luana followed behind, with Saoven bringing up the rear. It didn't escape Janir that Luana looked her over with a somewhat suspicious glance. She hated having her allegiances questioned, especially when she was going to give up her life, her freedom, so they could live.
Lady Gwenna, Janir moved forward. Are you all right? Fine. Thank you, Gwenna replied. Though haggard and pale, the noblewoman appeared otherwise unscathed.
Do you know the way out?
Velasquez asked. Janir glanced around. She was not accustomed to leading. Janir stammered. I'm not sure.
We need to find my sword,
Armandius calmly stated.
I cannot risk that falling into the hands of our enemies.
You mean any more than it already has?
Velasquez dryly replied. Armandius ignored the other man's comment. They were all used to Velasquez's humorless demeanor by now.
Lord Caerson and I will seek out the third, Luana proposed. You and Saoven will take the others as close as you can to the stables, and we will meet you there.
No one dissented. With Luana and Velasquez as guides, finding their way back to one another would not be difficult. Gwenna seemed reluctant to release Armandius's hand. Janir noticed how their gazes lingered on one another before Armandius retreated down the hall with the elven woman. Janir frowned, though she wasn't sure how she should or did feel about what she was seeing.
Stay close, my lady,
Velasquez urged, speaking to Gwenna.
Saoven, attend her ladyship.
Kyle, watch Janir.
Saoven ever so briefly touched Janir's back before moving to take a place beside Gwenna. Kyle stepped up beside the maiden and gave her a reassuring grin as they began to move.
Onwards!
Velasquez led them through the maze of the temple, even as the sounds of conflict grew louder by the moment. The wails of Karkatan rang out above the shrieks of the morsains. Janir had an uncanny feeling that the monsters were taking the worst of this fight. Janir paled, and shivers went down her spine. There was power. Argatolum power fast approaching. More sources than she had time to count. Janir frantically glanced from one side to the other of the winding hall.
What is it?
Kyle whispered, trying to keep his voice down.
He's close, Janir whispered. I can feel him, he...
She cut herself off when she spotted Luana and Armandius emerging from a narrow passage up ahead. They were both just a little more rumpled than they had been before, and Janir wondered if they had encountered any more morsains.
Armandius carried the third slung over his shoulder along with Saovin's sword, and Luana bore her reclaimed weapon along with her brother's. There was a brief pause whilst weapons were distributed. Janir tried to stay calm. She could hear the noise of the battle in the distance, and there was no reason to think her father knew where they were. Still.
"We need to hurry,"
she said. Several heads turned in her direction.
"Do you think we're dancing a gavotte? Of course we are hurrying,"
Velasquez clipped, lashing his sword belt around his hips.
"No, you don't understand. It's my father. He's..."
Their shocked faces warned her only an instant before a hand snatched a handful of her hair.
You have been listening to Broken Enchantments, written and read by Elizabeth Wheatley. Don't forget to check out my Patreon for early access to episodes, bonus content, and lots of patrons-only freebies. You can learn more at elizabethwheatley.com. And don't forget to subscribe on your favorite podcast platform or YouTube. I'll see you next time.